Hey, horse people. Haven't watched the boys eat. Want to talk about a couple things. Those chickens get my coffee, there's going to be problems. So you see feathers fly. You better get away from that coffee, you're in big trouble. Hey, you're in big trouble. So, I got a couple of points that I thought I would cover a little bit more because there was confusion. I think that sun's kind of blocking me a little bit. Why are these chickens putting pressure on me? Hey, why are you guys putting pressure on me? Go eat some grasshoppers. They're eating all my trees. Some lady wrote, which I'm going to try to move this because I think that sun's kind of going to get in the way here. Let me move it to the other. Mr. T's like, dude, why are you carrying that camera? What's going on? Mr. T. He's like, you guys can go ahead and eat, but I'm going to pay attention to what the hell this guy's crazy guy with the coffee is talking to somebody. All right, that's probably a little bit better. So, a lady asked on one of the videos, actually on a couple videos, Buddy pulled. There's chickens. Maybe Buddy will get one of them flying here. Put a hoof at them. Chickens are pretty quick. You guys quit stalking me. Freaking doing an episode of the birds. Alfred Hitchcock. what Buddy was tied to a post and alright. You guys are distracting me. Knock it off. Big trouble. So what happened is Buddy pulled on a rope and he started pulling, and as immediately as he pulled, you saw me back up. And some lady wrote a pretty good question, shows she's paying attention. Damn chicken's got 10 acres, he's gonna get right underneath me. What are you doing? Go eat. Guys are being a pain in the chicken. When Buddy pulls and I moved away, some lady wrote, you release pressure. Couldn't that be confused as the right answer is pulling because you stop pressure? Aha. For the amateur, that may be true. For the horseman who understands the deeper picture, that's not true. It's true to a certain extent. Anytime a horse gets released immediately and he connects the release with the release of all pressure, he will learn to do that. When a horse pulls and people rush and try to help him, or they continue pressure and they don't move away and they don't give that horse a position to move to for release. These chickens are killing me. Dude. Come on, fly away. You're going to get in big trouble. A horse has to be able to associate the release with an action. When a horse pulls, he is pulling from pressure that either I'm putting or that someone else is putting or that he feels, and he's trying to get away. When he pulls, the rope gets tight. When the rope gets tight, it pulls on his head and ears and neck. That is more pressure. I cannot release that pulling on his pressure unless I convince him to move forward to release his own pressure. So if I go to the front of him and I try to help him or I continue pressure, he feels the pressure from me, but now his pressure is diverted to his head and neck where he feels that rope pulling and he can't get away and he's trapped. He has that emotional space pressure that I can't get away. I'm killing these chickens, that's it. Hey, you're going to get in big trouble. Get out. So I cannot relieve that pressure on his head. No matter how I help, I end up putting more pressure. And that's a big misconception out there with horse people when they're dealing with horses. You have to realize that it's not only what you do, what you say, which way you face, how you move, whether you move in or out. what the horse is feeling, whether he's in a small area, whether he's in a corner, whether he feels trapped, whether he sees no escape, whether he sees his only release is through you, so he runs over you, and you think he's being mean. It's all about perception on what the horse is feeling. If you think like, you know, I guess it would be like if you're standing there and I pull my car forward and I roll my tire over your foot, and I stop, my tire's on your foot. You're going to be screaming, cussing, yelling, ow, it hurts, jumping up and down, but you can't move because your foot is under my tire. Now, if I go, oh, I'm sorry I put pressure on you, let me get out of the car and walk away. That doesn't stop the pressure of the tire on your foot. It only stops the pressure of me and what I'm doing. Until that tire gets off your foot, you're still going to feel... That damn chicken's pecking this thing. I'm going to beat him like a red-headed rooster. Hey, what the... Get away from there. You're in big trouble. So pressure is only... It's not only what you do if you reach. That's the problem with understanding pressure and release with horses. And it's so... That's why when I work with dogs, working with horses is so different. Because with dogs... They don't perceive pressure like that. They almost perceive some pressure as good because they like that prey kill. They like to chase. When somebody runs from a dog and a dog chases it, it's fun. Now, the person who's scared and running and the dog is chasing it, the person doesn't think it's fun. But in the initial onset, a dog has what's called a prey kill instinct, and he has this uncontrollable urge when something runs to chase it. Kind of like the theory that people say that I like to chase rabbits when I'm walking through the pasture, like a dog does. If you're walking through a pasture or a dog sees a rabbit, he chases it. And then after the rabbit gets away, he comes back to you and he's friendly and he's walking and everything's fine till another rabbit jumps out. And then he just can't help himself. They have to chase things because they have this prey kill instinct. Well, with horses, they have this kind of like flea instinct. That whenever there's a problem or something I don't understand, I got to get away. Fleeing is my safety. Running. Fight or flight. I don't want to fight. I got to flight. So they want to run and get away. So understanding that pressure, I mean, you could talk about this forever and give examples, but it's really hard to get through a new horse person. They may be able to quote somebody saying, oh, that's pressure and release. Oh, you got to do pressure and release. Oh, give pressure. Oh, don't stop pressure. That's all fine and dandy, but unless you understand the big picture, you have to know pressure and release and how it affects the horse. What is the horse seeing? What is the horse understanding out of the lesson? What is the horse learning? Too many people get caught up on what they're teaching. Kind of like this lady that asked me a question. It's a good question because she's like, look, when Buddy pulled, you didn't want him to pull, but you stopped putting pressure and you backed away. Wouldn't that tell him that pulling is the right answer because you stopped pressure? If that was the only pressure he was getting, and I knew that he was connecting him being trapped with me, then that might be correct. But that wasn't what's happening. Because when I stopped pressure, Buddy kept pulling for a second. He had to figure out how to relieve his own pressure. And how he figured that... I'm going to kick this chick. That's it. Big trouble. You have to realize that people go, you can't stay on topic. Well, no shit, I got chickens trying to attack me. Damn liberals, why can't you get chicken control? Chickens are dangerous. They're assault chickens. Sorry, flashback to my gun channel. So understanding pressure and release, it's all about what the horse is feeling. I'm a biggie on you have to think like a horse. Well, you have to understand how a horse thinks, and it's not just that I run when I'm scared or that I don't want to flight or that speed is my friend. You have to understand what lessons does a horse learn. Okay, this gate over here is open, and usually when I open this gate, Buddy likes to go out there and get into stuff because he knows. But in the morning when I come out here and either give them their carrots and their apple and they get their little hay, I leave the gate open. Rick, hang on, I see a barn witch. Rick, that's dangerous. That horse could get out of that gate and he could get hurt and you should never leave a gate. Okay, the horse ain't got neither one of them's got a drive or a want to go out that gate. Why? Because they have a stronger drive and want for the food that I have. So when the old timers used to say, what's in it for the horse? When you're training a horse, you gotta ask yourself a question. What's in it for a horse? If you ever train a mule, you better ask what's in it for the mule, because you'll never train it, and you'll teach them to say no, and you'll have a fight on your hands, because a mule will fight you. There are a lot of good horsemen that can't, I've worked very minimal with a couple mules, and I can understand them a little bit, because they're still in the equine species, but they're not like a horse. They're much more thinkers. They're much more methodical. They kind of think ahead. They're a little bit more complex thinkers. I think their brain's a little bit more advanced, because they just seem to think a little bit more. So you have to use different techniques with a mule than you do a horse. They're almost the same, and you can get away with it, but somebody that's a bully to a horse will let you bully him, and a horse will let you beat him up, and a horse will do it because he's just scared, he's tired of resisting. Whereas a mule, he'll remember that, and he won't just do it. Or he may just, like I said, I think I brought this up before, if you want to teach a horse to lead and he's always pulling, tie his butt to a mule at night, and in the morning when you get up, he'll be leading. He'll be following that mule. Because he could pull all night and want to rear and pull away, and that mule will look at him and go, dude, I ain't moving. Ain't nothing you gonna do gonna get me to move. Pretty soon a horse figures out, pulling don't get me the right answer. Following this mule around and quit pulling gets me the right answer. Well, now I'm not suggesting that you, like some dummies did, this lady sent her horse to a trainer, and this lady was teaching how to lead, so she tied it back to the back of her pickup or quad and dragged the horse around a pasture and make it run behind there with a rope and a halter, and said that was training it to lead. That's not, it doesn't work that way, because people, if you were tied a horse to a mule, he would be there all night and there would be no release. It's not like the mule has anything else to do. When humans go out and train, they're on an agenda. They're on a time schedule. I got to hurry up and do this. I got other things to do. I got to leave. Hi, Moki. What are you doing, little Moki, with your little winter coat? Hi, Moki, Smoky, Moki. It got really nippy here in Texas here last night. Shoot, it was dropped down. It was 100 during the day, and it dropped down to like 58, 57 in the morning. I was like, brr. So Smoky started getting his winter coat. The horses are starting to fur up just a little bit. But back to the original topic, that pressure and release. Big topic, big understanding. Hard to understand sometimes. But if you always default back to the horse, what do I think the horse learned? Where you going, Moki? The chicken's left. Now Moki's rubbing on my legs. Go eat with the horsies. Pressure and release. What is the horse learning? Default should always be, I wonder what my horse learned. Well, how can you tell what your horse learned? Well, if you can repeat it, then it learned. That's why when you put a chain on a horse and you pull over his nose, you put those stupid stud chains, and they can't call them stud chains anymore. Well, if you call a stud chain, it's kind of cool, because that means you got a real tough horse and you need it to control your horse, because your horse is so stubborn and he acts like a stud. So a lot of women like to use that as a macho thing. Men use it just to paint a horse so they ain't got to mess with the horse, so they can hurt the horse really quick and easy, and a horse ain't going to resist or fight with them, and they don't have to use any common sense or horsemanship skills. But a chain, and there's a lot of barns out there, mainly run by women. You can get mad at me for being a sexist, but you go to all these barns, and they have the policy you can't lead a horse without a chain over its nose, because they've had so many horses get away. That's not the damn horses that get away. It's all the damn dummies that buy the horses that don't know what they're doing that let them get away. So the fix is not to train the people or have them do better. Let's put pain and get a chain over a horse's nose. It just doesn't work. What happens is you desensitize the nose over time, because people who use chains don't know how to use pressure and release. They don't understand a horse. They don't know how to give release with timing so the horse learns. So they end up pulling and yanking and doing, and pretty soon the horse's nose is numb. There's nerve damage. There's hair loss. And it hurts the horse, and you know what? The horse learns to work through the pain. Just like a horse learns to work through and I hear somebody yelling in the pasture. They were hunting over there earlier. I was when I was making my coffee, I kept hearing guns shooting. I was thinking of the question, how do you get your horses used to gunfire? Well, you have them out in the pasture where they're hunting, and a couple pastures over, and they're shooting all day, and that pretty much help them. Not bad on their ears. So I, understanding pressure and release. The other question I got, and this is the other thing that I wanted to cover, is what when a horse bucks you, or when a horse does something wrong, you know the old saying, if a horse acts up, the worst thing you can do is get off and then leave and let the horse understand that by acting up, I get the person to leave me alone. I get release of pressure by acting bad. I get release of pressure by doing something, and then the human gets scared, nervous, confused, doesn't know what they're doing, so they stop putting pressure on me and leave me alone. So whatever I was doing, I learned to do that. Now, the old saying is, if a horse bucks you off, you need to get back in the saddle. And I've heard this, and I've talked about that. That's not always a good idea. However, you don't want a horse learning that if it threatens to buck, or that it tries to buck, you get off. And you release that pressure, and you leave them alone. So how can you continue pressure without necessarily getting back on maybe a dangerous horse and getting hurt? Well, a lot of people say, take that horse to the round pen, lunge him, make him do a million circles. The theory behind that is somewhat correct, but there's a bigger lesson being learned. You don't want the horse to be able to control that you can get off when he acts up, and then you take him to the round pen, you run the crap out of him, and by the time you get to the round pen, he has disconnected that you got off him and that he's getting round pinned because he acted up when you got off him. Now, if he acts up in the round pen, you get off and round pin him, that's pretty quick, and you do it quick, then he may connect that and he may go, you know what, I'd rather have the stupid human sitting on my back and walking calmly than have the crazy human in the middle of the arena screaming, yelling, chasing me with a whip like a maniac. So what is good pressure and bad pressure? It depends. But if a horse gets you off him, you just don't want to make it a reward. Too many people, and I had some guy email me about, he runs a barn or something, and he has a bunch of women out there that he can't talk to and he can't give advice because they know everything, because they read a book, because they watched a website. Hopefully they're not saying, well, Rick said that you... I don't think they are, because he'd be like, I watched Rick and he didn't say that shit. But he was saying that these women, every time their horse acts up, they think they're punishing them. They run up, I'm going to put you in a stall. They run them to stall. Then they give them a treat before they leave because they want the horse to love them. And I'm like, are you kidding me? I was watching, Dr. Phil was on in the background the other day when I was doing something, either working on a gun or working on my website, something. And he was doing a show on kids out of control. And there was a stinking five-year-old kid. Well, actually, there was three kids and three mothers. And all three mothers were saying their kids were out of control. And I'm sitting here thinking, damn, that sounds like a lot of women that write me about their horses out of control. Oh, I know, I'm a sexist. Well, Dr. Phil's a sexist because he had three of them on there. So he's on there asking them, what are they doing and how's it working? And that's a good question. When you look at a horse and you look at what you're doing, you need to ask yourself, how's that working out? Because, and I've said this before in a different way, if you're doing the same thing every time and it becomes a routine that you have to get off and lunge your horse, that you have to get off and take your horse to the round pen, that you have to do so much lunging before you ride, that you have, and the horse is dictating what you're doing, how's that working out for you? Some people are going to say it works out pretty good because he hasn't thrown me since I've done that, so I would rather do that every time than take the possibility of being thrown. Well, yeah, but wouldn't it be better to understand why he's slowing you and why you're losing that respect and why don't you have that respect that enough that you don't have to round pin your horse or run him in circles and lunge the crap out of him before you get on him? Wouldn't that be nice to be able to know that my horse, anytime I'm around him, he kind of knows to not push me or not tell me no or to not resist? Of course it would be better, but... You know, if you tell somebody that, they're going to say, well, it doesn't work, or it takes so much time, or I don't have enough time, or I live too far from a barn, and I have to drive, or I have other people handling it, or it's not me, it's the people that feed it, or other people, you know, I get a lot of questions about, my horse is at a barn, and I know what I'm doing, and I'm doing it right, but other people that are feeding my horse and handling my horse are doing it wrong. How can I fix that? You can't. You either, come on. It's like me sitting over here in the U.S. saying, well, I'd like to stop world hunger. How can I do that? And then doing nothing. I mean, you have to take action. It takes some. You have to do something in order to stop something. You can't just ask me for an answer. The answer is you either don't have your horse in a barn, you don't let other people handle it, you spend more time with your horse, you move your horse to a place to where nobody handles it. I mean, I would probably rather, if I couldn't get out to my horses and they were at a barn, I would probably rather people handle it if it was between them sitting in a stall and getting out. I'd rather them be handled bad to get out in a pasture, because that limited time that they're being handled to get out of pasture, being out in pasture far outweighs for 8 hours the small damage that somebody does because they lead them incorrectly, because they teach them a bad habit, because they let them nip them, because they're scared of them. Those little short lessons, like I said, I don't really give a shit if other people are scared of my horse. It's like the old Bazooka Joe comic book that used to get bubblegum. A lot of you kids won't remember this. Some of the old timers remember this. Bubblegum used to come in a little bitty wrapper and had a little cartoon on it, like the Sunday comics. Hell, I don't even know if they got Sunday comics anymore in a paper. But you'd unroll your bubblegum and there'd be Bazooka Joe. Bazooka Joe was kind of some goofy knucklehead. And one of the Bazooka Joes that was real common, because they'd repeat the comics on some of the bubblegum, is dude walks up to him and says, "Does your dog bite?" And he goes, "No." The guy reaches over, the dog bites him, and the guy says, "Hey, I thought you said your dog don't bite." Bazooka Joe said, "He don't bite me." So, if my horse is mean to other people, I don't care. If you want to run from my horse and teach my horse to chase you, well, then you're a dummy. I don't really want my horse becoming dangerous and chasing people if I'm at a, because other people will get chased and start labeling the horse as being mean. But if it's just between you and my horse's feelings... Oh, shit, I sucked in a bug. Oh. Well, he's buzzing around my belly fast now. He just had a big old swig of coffee. Woo. So, stupid gnat. You need to understand that if you let other people handle your horse, let them handle it. If it helps your horse and it's better in the long run, then you know what? You need to spend more time dealing with it, how to correct it. Just because my horses would kick somebody else does not mean they would kick me. I know a lot of horses that don't kick their owner, but they kick at other people. I know a lot of horses that don't bite their owner, but they bite at other people. I know a lot of horses that pin their ears at people, but they don't pin it at their owner. Or when they do pin it, the owner ignores it and the horse goes, "Oh, that didn't give me anything," so they stop. But the other people, when they pin ears, they move away. "Oh, he's mad. Get away. He's going to bite you. Oh, you shouldn't let him pin his ears, because if he does, he's going to... It's dangerous." All right, whatever. Go ahead. Keep regurgitating what everyone else says. Okay? I'm a biggie and not telling you what to think. I would rather you learn how to think. Because if you learn how to think, it's better for the horse. If you learn how a horse thinks, it's a lot better than me telling you, "Okay, this is what a horse thinks. Okay, this is what it means when he pins his ears. Okay, this is what it means when he did this." You just listen to me. You don't have to think. You don't have to know why. You just listen to me, and when I tell you the reason why this horse drops his head to eat is because there's a psychological barrier that he can't use his mouth. Some woman writes me and tells me a horse can't run when he's eating. That's the knucklehead who horse trainer in California, when I was at that one barn where the horses ran in each other because they put a stupid light in a pasture and it blinded the horses. Another knucklehead goes out there and scares the horses, and one horse runs out of the light, one horse is running in the light, and they run in each other at full speed and kill each other. And they drop to the ground, and one of the horses has hay in their mouth. And this woman calls the cops and says, "Somebody killed my horses, and horses can't run." She's putting this in the paper. The cops are writing it down in a report because he don't know shit about a horse. The newspapers report, "No, and the horse had grass in its mouth, and horses can't run with grass. Horses can't run when they're eating. So therefore, something happened or somebody shot it." And I'm like, are you kidding me? You freaking idiots believe all this crap? A horse can't run when he's eating. Man, if that word got out to the lions, tigers, panthers, and other predators, man, horses would be open season. Okay, guys, here we go. Horses can't run when they're eating. So, and you know how much horses eat. So every time they drop their head to eat, we're just going to walk on over there, kill them, and eat them. Okay? Horses would be extinct pretty damn quick if they couldn't run when they were eating. I mean, give me a break. But you know what? She was telling everybody that. Everyone else was repeating it. She was putting herself off as an expert because she knew what she was doing. She owned horses her own life. This was her 14th horse she earned, so that means it's good. See, in my opinion, when somebody says this is my 14th horse, that tells me you're an idiot. You keep buying horses because you don't know what you're doing, so you keep blaming the horse, thinking the horse is bad. So you're always looking for the better horse because you don't know how to make the horse you got or let the horse you have become the best horse he is. You're too damn busy getting his way and beating him. All horses are good. Remember, there's not ever a horse born bad. They are made. When every horse hits the ground, they are a horse. They are a good horse. They are the best horse that has ever walked. You have people with Trigger and all these other famous horses. All those horses hit the ground just like every other horse. And they were made to be the horse they were by the person that handled them and that took care of them. Just like the horse lady and Buck that had the mean horse that was attacking people. I still got people writing me defending this damn lady. So, alright, kind of got off on a few topics there. Understanding how a horse thinks, understanding when you give release, understanding that if you get thrown off a horse, the last thing you want to do is immediately release all pressure. So I don't want to go, oh, he got scared and he bucked me. Let me take the saddle off. Let me bring him back to his stall. Let me go let him out in pasture. Let me give him a carrot. Pretty soon, if you do that a few times, the horse is going to learn, damn, you know what? When I buck, this dummy gives me food and takes the saddle off. I don't like having a saddle on. I don't like having a cinch on my belly. You know what? Let me try this theory, because horses are always trying and thinking. They try to repeat behavior. That's why they're so easy to train. That's why they're always learning people so quick, because people don't understand that they're doing the same thing and a horse is testing them, saying, let me see if I do this again, if I can get the human to do this. Let me see if I pin my ears, if I can make this human move away. There's a lot of horses out there that learn this over the years, and people label them as mean because they pin their ears and swish or tell people. And I'm like, man, people have taught this horse perfectly. Somebody's taught this horse how to be a great ear pinner by running away and saying, oh, get away. Get away. When a horse pins his ears, he's going to bite you. Again, telling people how to think, or telling people what to think, instead of educating them on how to think, how a horse think, what the horse is thinking, what is the horse's thought process behind it, what's his instinctual drive that makes him think what he thinks. It's not because he's mean or malicious. A horse is pure. They keep us honest. They're honest. They don't hide their feelings. They're not worried about being politically correct. They're not worrying if they hurt our feelings. That's why when I'm roughing all these women and they're like crying and ooh, they're writing YouTube, this guy's mean. He called people a dummy. That's illegal. You idiots. That's why they can't make it with a horse. That's why they're running around the internet trying to fix all their problems with a horse. Because they don't get it. A horse doesn't care if you get your feelings hurt. If you get your feelings hurt from me, a horse is going to hurt your feelings a lot more. When I'm hard on you, I'm trying to be hard on you so you can get over your hurt feelings, so you realize that just because I do something that hurts your feelings doesn't make me wrong, doesn't make what I'm saying have any less credibility. It merely is the way it's presented to you, and you want things presented in your own way, just like the horse wants things presented in their way. The only difference is the horse wants it because he thinks he's going to die in his survival. You want it because you're spoilt and you're whiny and you think everyone should be kissing your butt and nobody should ever hurt your feelings and everybody should be politically correct and you should never say a bad word and everything should be handed to you with sprinkles on top. And then you get pissed off when it isn't, so you stop learning, you shut down, you get mad, you disengage. That's what people do to horses. My horse kicked me. I don't like him. I'm locking him up. I'm selling him. I'm going to get a chain. That horse isn't a good horse. He needs a mean, aggressive leader. I got to be tough on him because if I'm not, he's dangerous. Just like the woman and Buck, and the theory goes on and on and on. Nothing changes. The horse just, you know, they get new people that don't know. That's why ponies are so stinking mean, because they learn the same bad lessons from every new owner every 6 months or a year. As soon as the kids outgrow them, they go to the next person, and they bring all those lessons of their whole life. And then people want to say, ponies are mean. Every time I see a pony, he bites. He tries to kick. Blah, 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 blah. So, that's kind of like me, blah, 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 blah. Mr. T, did you notice the whole time I'm talking here, Mr. T has slowly worked himself to the other side of Buddy. And he's got a barrier of Buddy, and he can face me and see what the hell I'm up to. And Buddy's pretty much standing in the safe spot. He's like, dude, I just want the best hay. I'm moving just enough to get the best hay. But Mr. T has nonchalantly, doing his whole film, slyly, and maneuvered himself around to the other side to where, you know what, I can hide over here and he probably can't see me. And if he gets some crazy idea about riding or working us, maybe he'll pick Buddy instead of me. That's thinking like a horse. That's why I love Mr. T. Buddy, I love him too. He's a good old boy. All right, well, in that there, hope that helps. I'm at 9.5. Buddy and Mr. T, you're good boys. Like, dude, just give us some more of this good old oat hay. See y'all.